All right, we will call the last case on the calendar, which is Coleman versus Brown. And I guess I should say, since both of you are, we're not going to have you come up twice, okay? So we'll hear first from counsel for, well, how are we going to? Yeah, we'll hear first from counsel for the state, right? And that's you. Okay, that's why I was trying to figure out who I'm looking at.
Yeah.
And I don't know if how much time you'll need, but we're hoping that maybe 25 minutes per side will be enough in the combined case.
Sure.
If you need a little bit more, obviously you've seen we're not going to cut you off. But we'll call you up once, so say everything you have to say on both appeals, and then we'll hear from counsel for the plaintiffs, and then you'll have some time for rebuttal. Okay.
Good morning, Your Honors, and may it please the court. Kevin Voth for defendants. I'd like to reserve 5 minutes for rebuttal. Over the last two decades, the state of California has put into place a comprehensive system for the delivery of mental health care for nearly 40,000 inmates, including crisis bed and inpatient levels of care. Now, that was the original objective of the judgment in this case, and the orders on appeal now illustrate how this action has shifted from that systemic goal to policing the procedures and policies regarding from the what's called the program guide, which is a compendium of protocols and policies regarding nearly every aspect of mental health care treatment in prisons. Now, these orders, which mandate 100% compliance with the program guide's transfer timelines, is inconsistent with the Eighth Amendment and the Prison Litigation Reform Act's restrictions on prospective relief and should be reversed. Now, this first appeal concerns the program guide's 24-hour transfer timeline for mental health crisis beds and the district court's orders requiring the state to do two things. First, to attain for the first time 100% compliance with that transfer timeline, and secondly, to refrain from implementing two operational policies that would affect how the timeline is measured. Now, because courts may not order prospective relief that is not necessary to correct a constitutional violation, the central question that's presented in these appeals is whether anything less than permanent 100% compliance with the transfer timelines amounts to cruel and unusual punishment on the under the Eighth Amendment.
Okay, well, I mean, subject to exceptions that you all are still working out, or have those been worked out now?
With respect to the inpatient timelines, there have been some preliminary exceptions. The court in its order stated that it believed that at the very least there were two situations that should be accepted, which involving more urgent medical needs and when an inmate is out to court for some other reason. And those exceptions essentially recognize that there's some circumstances where the timeline simply shouldn't apply, where the state would be caught in a catch-22, either required to disregard the timelines or disregard another court's order or more urgent medical needs.
Could I just be sure, are you talking about the 24-hour now?
Right now we're talking about the 24-hour, and there's been discussions and negotiations about the exceptions, but they haven't become formalized.
Okay.
And I'm sorry. As I read in the briefs, at the time the notice of appeal was filed, the party seemed to be engaging in discussions that about how one would proceed in the future, and that it's not clear. What troubled me about that was that those discussions, which could have led to somewhat of a different ruling, so to speak, were cut off by the notice of appeal, because the judge said, we got to stop since the notice of appeal deprives me of jurisdiction. So do we actually know what the final outcome of these discussions would have been and what the final planning guide would have looked like?
I don't think we know exactly what the final exception would look like in the program guide. Those, except for the two specific ones that I mentioned before, and then a third that is still trying to be worked out with respect to things that are, quote-unquote, beyond defendant's control, and what exactly that means, subject to the special master's input and the negotiation of the parties.
How do we rule on this without knowing what the final, what we're finally ruling at? Is this a final order in that sense?
I believe it is a final order in that sense, regardless of the specific delineation of the exceptions, because all the exceptions really do is establish the parameters under which the state will be required to achieve 100% compliance. The Corps was explicit about what it believed. It said 100%, subject to these limited exceptions that the Corps specifically cautioned should not swallow the rule. And within those parameters, the state is still being held to a 100% compliance standard.
It's basically an injunction, isn't it? You can always kind of fiddle a little bit with an injunction without destroying the appealability of it.
That's correct, Your Honor. In effect, what the all the state is still within the parameters of the exceptions is still being required to essentially operate the transfer timelines or to administer them in a flawless way, so that there can only be any deviation in the district court's view would be a constitutional violation. And the Corps was unambiguous about that.
Well, doesn't the court have some discretion in deciding whether or not you're going to comply with the whole thing or creating some exceptions? I mean, I'm not sure I understand the argument that it wouldn't comply with the Eighth Amendment if it were any different.
Yes, Your Honor. The court does have discretion in crafting certain remedies, but what the court cannot do is grant relief that would exceed the constitutional minimum. And what the court said here is that the 24 compliance, full and permanent compliance with the 24-hour timeline was necessary to satisfy the Eighth Amendment. So essentially the court is saying if you fall below, any deviation that falls below this 24-hour timeline is a Eighth Amendment violation. And that was an erroneous legal conclusion. And it disregarded the correct analysis as necessary under the Eighth Amendment, that there must be both objective harm and a subjective intent component. And by imposing this strict compliance standard, the district court disregarded that analysis.
So the district courts, as I understand it, the district court seemed to be saying that because 25 years ago, or how many ever years ago, there was an Eighth Amendment violation, and this plan was adopted to address that, she could proceed or he could proceed as if there was one today.
In effect, that is what the district court said and did, based on what the court said was the history sufficiently justified this type of injunctive relief. But the problem...
Go ahead. I just have one more question because I want to be clear. Was this a consent decree? Did you ever, or was it just an injunction that was ordered without opposition? I mean, what is the status of this planning guide or whatever?
It is not a consent decree, Your Honor. The program guide was developed with the assistance of the special master, the parties, the defendants' plan for creating the system to deliver mental health care that we believe exceeds what the Eighth Amendment requires. That plan was put together into the form that it is now, a large operational manual, essentially, and it's been changing over time. Now, in 2006, there was an order where the district court entered to immediately implement the provisions of the program guide. However, since that time, the program guide has itself changed. And in the program guide, there is no requirement that the state must perfectly adhere to all the transfer timelines or any of the specific and granular details as part of that order. The program guide itself acknowledges that there will be delays in transfers to higher levels of care, and it specifically provides terms that address how and the manner in which interim care is to be provided, how wait lists are going to be managed. And so the program guide itself contemplates that there's going to be these delays, which means that what the district court has done here by imposing this 100% compliance standard is doing something new, hadn't been done before.
Well, I guess, are you arguing that the court should have said you only have to comply with 90%? That seems rather arbitrary. It would seem sensible to say you comply with it, and then if there are instances in which there is not compliance, there could be a question as to whether or not there should be some kind of sanction.
Well, we're not asking that the court announce a specific numerical benchmark. What the court should have done below is it should have conducted the correct analysis under the Eighth Amendment. If the court's going to grant an injunction, grant prospective relief, then under the PLRA, it must determine that there is a current and existing constitutional violation.
And it found that.
It found that.
In this particular case, though, however, Your Honor, it didn't do the correct analysis in reaching that conclusion. What the court said was it used the program guide's terms. It essentially conflated deviations from the program guide with an Eighth Amendment violation.
Maybe you can respond to the argument that ship has sailed, and because that's my view, is that this is now, the district court maybe had discretion under law of the case doctrine to revisit that, but this is we're way past that stage. You all had an opportunity in 2013, probably in 2014 as well, to take that up. As a matter of fact, you did appeal the 2013 denial, and then you abandoned it, or something happened, and we never got it. So I just think that ship has sailed, and I don't know why for one second we would think about diving back into that. You all came up with a program guide, lays out what, in the view of the state, was necessary to meet the Eighth Amendment, to cure the Eighth Amendment violation, and the district court in those prior orders said that the program guide basically sets the Eighth Amendment floor. And that's all the district court did here was to hold you to that, no?
Well, what the district court did in the previous orders, and I think that the problem is that the court can't rely on old findings and old determinations. This court in Gilmore said that in order to show a current and ongoing constitutional violation, it can't be based on the prior record. It must be based on the current record. And in doing so, in relying on those old findings as well, what the court did was the court didn't previously say that the program guide is the Eighth Amendment floor, the constitutional floor. The court said that the program guide is grounded in defendants' understanding of the Eighth Amendment, and that's not the same thing as saying that a deviation from the program guide's timelines or its terms is a constitutional violation that justifies prospective relief.
But I thought that, let's just talk about the crisis beds, right, that it was agreed that there had been an Eighth Amendment violation in the sense that it was taking too long between the time of referral and to the time of placement or whatever it is. I don't have all the terminology down, but you know what I'm talking about. And I thought it was concluded with the state's acquiescence that 24 hours was the period that essentially was necessary to cure the Eighth Amendment violation that had been occurring, right? And so that was you all were ordered to make sure that everybody would be referred within 24 hours. And then as of at least 2017, I can't remember the numbers, but there were some substantial number of inmates who it was taking longer than that. So you all weren't in compliance with what the program guide spelled out. And what was the district court supposed to do? Other than say, look, you need to comply with this. I'm serious. This wasn't, we weren't just playing games here. I recognize there are going to be situations that are outside of the state's control, and we'll work on developing exceptions for those. But in all other cases, you do have to do it within 24 hours. I don't understand what's wrong with that.
Well, I think that, and no one is disputing that 24 hours is a reasonable amount of time to transfer these inmates who have been referred. But the problem is that what the court has done is to announce a constitutional compliance standard. And if falling below 100% compliance is sufficient to justify prospective relief, then that's also the standard that the state has to meet in order to terminate relief. Mm-hmm. And in a case like this, where you have a complex injunction and where the state is contending with it's a massive system that deals with many moving parts. And on a monthly basis, there are almost 1,500 crisis bed referrals and 15,000 crisis bed referrals per year, that a deviation simply falling below a 100% threshold could constitute a constitutional violation. That's a constitutional standard that's it's unreasonable, and it's not supported by the proper Eighth Amendment analysis.
Maybe you can go back, and maybe it was Judge Schroeder's question. So if not what the district court did, what's the alternative exactly? Just, try your best, and hopefully you'll meet it in most cases. And, you know, I however many people commit suicide in the interim, well, that's just a cost of doing business here. I mean, what is the district court supposed to do if not say, no, I'm serious, you must do this, that is what you all agreed to, and it was the terms were in most cases. Now come up with the description of the very small subset of cases where you'll be excused, because everyone recognizes we're not trying to be unreasonable. What's the alternative to that you think the district court should have imposed?
There were less intrusive means for the court to effectuate the timeline compliance. And defendants presented various proposals and processes that they were implementing, and including increasing capacity and taking additional measures that were going to accelerate timeframes. And the court can oversee that and require those things be done, but what it cannot do is announce that 100% compliance is going to be the constitutional standard, that any deviation that falls below is going to...
But it's not any in an absolute sense, right? Because there are the exceptions that will be worked out. I guess I'm just stumbling over that. I hear you. If you were to say, like, no matter what, even if, you know, there's an earthquake, and, you know, it's impossible, an act of God intervenes, and you're going to be held in contempt. Okay, I understand that, but that's not what we're talking about, right? So why isn't it, if you're just going to carve out the small subset of cases in which, due to circumstances essentially beyond your control, there more time was needed, why isn't it okay to insist that, no, you are going to comply in all of the rest of the cases? Isn't that what always happens when somebody is ordered to do something of this sort on a programmatic nature?
Well, I think that because it still is overbroad in terms of what that 100% requires, ultimately the state can only implement its system through people and through its actors and their professionals, but there's still
If the standard is too high, then that, going back to what Judge Watford was asking, that seems to be something that should have been appealed when the original order was entered, doesn't it?
And I disagree, Your Honor. I think that the fact that the district court entered an order that said immediately implement the program guides provisions was not sufficiently, that's not specific enough to say that, well, in reality, what you need to do is ensure a flawless performance of the system.
And didn't the original plan say in most cases 24 hours?
That's correct, Your Honor. It says in most cases... The transfers will be affected in 24 hours.
And I thought you had some discrete problems with this, that you wanted to count you didn't want the 24 hours to include transportation.
That's correct.
And you didn't want, and you wanted to be able to have an evaluation made by a professional about the need, because many people who were sent actually was sent back as not needing that care. That those were the issues that you really had problems with. Am I right?
Yes, Your Honor, that is correct.
So those are the two things that bother you.
Those two policies, the way that it came about, the court asked for the parties to talk about obstacles to compliance, and one of the main obstacles to affecting timely transfers is the problem of rescissions, which is what you were mentioning. And
but that goes to the issue of whether a professional evaluation should be made.
That's correct.
I think that brings me to a question just as a point of information. How was it determined initially that these people who we're talking about need this bed? Who decides initially who has to be moved within 24 hours?
A clinician makes that decision initially.
A clinician, what kind of a clinician? A doctor?
A psychiatrist or a psychologist.
So what more do you want in terms of the third objection that you had?
Well, the problem is that in instances where there's no on-site clinician and then the initial assessment cannot be done face-to-face, and in many instances what happens is a nurse simply relays information over the phone to the on-call clinician, who then makes a determination of the referral. And during these, which it usually happens in these after-hours settings, it contributes to this high level of rescissions. What Dr. Brezenadine, our chief psychologist, testified to was that face-to-face evaluations are a better way to assess, to more accurately assess the need.
I forget how much, and the district court mentioned it, but how much longer does it, because these things happen at night, or it could happen on a Friday night, and somebody might be seen on Monday. Generally speaking, how long, an additional period of time, do those face-to-face evaluations take place, and in what percentage of the cases?
Typically, it would be several hours. If it happened at night, and then clinicians, whenever an inmate is placed into what's called alternative housing for when they're waiting for transfer to a crisis bed, they're required to be seen every day by a clinician. So at the very least, they would wait until the following morning to have an assessment that's done.
Now there's a horrendous description of some of what you call alternate housing in the district, I think in one of the district court's opinion. Is that description of current alternative housing, or was that what existed before?
No, Your Honor. Those things were from before. That was in the suicide expert's report. But in each of those instances, those were outlier situations, outlier where the policies were not being followed for alternative housing. And in addition, in a system where we're looking at 1,500 crisis bed referrals every month, these isolated incidents don't establish that there was a systemic problem here with the alternative housing program.
So let me be sure I answer. Your argument today is that forget about the findings from 25 years ago or 15 years ago, whatever. But if we were just looking at it as a new case, what goes on today would not be an Eighth Amendment violation. Is that your argument?
Yes, we would contend that that's true. That we're not, the way that the system currently operates is not systemically denying inmates ready access to care simply because the timelines are not met in every single instance. And in addition, there's the district court did not look at any subjective intent component of the Eighth Amendment analysis, which is also required. In the Supreme Court's precedent is clear that cruel and unusual punishment, subjective intent is inherent in the Eighth Amendment's cruel and unusual punishment clause.
So essentially your argument is that the district court is saying you're stopped because of what happened decades ago, and you agreed to a remedy, those conditions that existed then. You can't come back and say there's no more Eighth Amendment violation, and therefore you're bound, in effect, by this 24-hour period.
In a way, Your Honor, what the court has said is that because of what has happened in the past, then it's no longer necessary to do a further analysis.
But it's a long time in the past. past.
Right. Yes, a very long time.
But this has been under constant court's supervision since the case was instituted, has it not?
But didn't the district court at one point in 2013, I believe, praise the progress that had been made?
Yes, Your Honor, and it was specifically in the inpatient context, the court said that remarkable accomplishments and that defendants were in compliance. It said that it wasn't enough to justify termination of all relief, but it said that the defendants had come into compliance with respect to that.
Did you want to address at all the other appeal?
Yes, briefly, Your Honor.
Just briefly.
The other appeal, which deals with inpatient timelines and involves some of the same types of issues about 100% compliance and whether that's required under the Eighth Amendment. I would just, as an initial matter, note that I believe there is jurisdiction in this appeal as well. What the district court did is to enter an injunction.
What's different about your obligations after, this is the April order, right?
Yes, that's correct.
What's different afterwards as opposed to before? Because my impression was that the district court was just reiterating what you had already been ordered to do with no changes.
Mm-hmm. Because by requiring this full and permanent 100% compliance standard, it substantively changed defendants' remedial obligations. So before...
But remind me, the chart that I'm picturing in my mind, it didn't even have, for the 10 and 30 day, it didn't even have the, in most cases, qualifier that you have for the 24-hour time limit. It was just, you will comply with this set schedule of deadlines, right? There was, so you were just, and the district court had been incredibly patient with you all, waiting for you to come into compliance. There was all kinds of improvement and then backsliding, and at the end of the day, there was a big gap between what you all had agreed to do and what was being done, and all the district court said is, time's up. You are going to comply, and apparently what I've done before hasn't been good enough, so there are going to be sanctions, and I guess I don't see, how is that a new injunction?
The program guide, in fact, does acknowledge that there would be delays in the inpatient context as well, and it provides for wait lists, and it specifically discusses prioritization, and that's at 12-6-5 in the program guide, and 12-1-15, noting that some inmates may be placed on a wait list pending bed availability. So the program guide itself does acknowledge that there could be delays as well in the inpatient context. Now, the other thing that is important to note is that the prior orders, and the district court referred to these, all were relating to orders to reduce or eliminate the wait lists. And defendants produced plans to reduce and eliminate those wait lists, and they did that, as the district court acknowledged in the 2013 termination order. But what has happened here is that, and what those orders show is that something less than 100% compliance was acceptable to meet the constitutional standard, reducing the wait list to an acceptable level, not eliminating the wait list completely, which is what the 100% compliance standard that the district court imposed now, that's the effect of what the district court has done, is to change what those previous orders had meant. So we have, that is another reason that we have something new here. The relief is different than it was before. And the exceptions, in addition, I would say, also demonstrate that this is new relief. The fact that exceptions have to be articulated and negotiated and then incorporated into the program guide is another reason that we can see that this is, in fact, new relief. And so...
Why don't I ask you to pause? Let's hear from the plaintiffs, counsel for the plaintiffs. We'll give you your oh yeah, of course.
On page ER45, I guess, 173-28, there was a table that lists male acute psychiatric program and the various other programs. And for example, on male acute psychiatric program, it says the average daily census for 2017 was 328.2, and the beds needed were 365. And throughout all of this, in the high custody, it says beds needed 702, estimated 631. As I go through this, it doesn't seem to me that there's, and this is a California prison system with 38,000 people, it doesn't seem to me, how significant are these deviations now? I guess I should ask the question of your colleague, so maybe.
I would just say that it's a small population, but it's a large and complex system that requires a lot of resources to administer. And so, as I mentioned, we are looking at, in the inpatient context, there's some 2,200 approximately every year inmates who are admitted to inpatient care. And the 40,000 inmates, 38,000, 40,000 inmates, that's simply the inmates who are in the mental health delivery system itself. So while it's a small percentage of inmates, it is a large system and a complex system.
Okay, thank you. So we'll give you some time for rebuttal. Let's hear from counsel for the plaintiffs.
Good morning, Your Honor. I'm Lisa Ells. I represent the plaintiff class. This is not a case
Could
like
you move
the cases.
The mic a little down a little bit more so I can hear you better.
Use your outside voice. Checked.
Is this better?
Yeah.
This is not a case, Your Honor, where the findings of constitutional noncompliance were made 25 years ago and then never revisited. This court, on defendant's motion to terminate, specifically found in 2013 that the constitutional violation...
Yeah, not our court. You mean the district court.
Yeah, the district court. And it found that the constitutional violation of the failure to provide timely access to adequate care was ongoing. The Supreme Court in 2011 in this case found that same constitutional violation remained ongoing and current, and there was more than sufficient evidence before the district court that those violations were still causing harm and that they had not been abated. Defendants have never moved under Rule 60 or the PLRA to terminate or modify any aspect of the timelines or the orders at issue in these appeals. They also have never remediated or offered any other alternative about how they might remediate these violations, even though the district court has said repeatedly that that is an option that is available to them.
But it, they may have, as I asked your colleague,
yes,
with respect to the most people that they have, as I understand, they have the quarrel they have with the district court, aside from 100% compliance, is that they don't want to count the transportation. And they want to have it, the person examined face to face by a psychiatrist, I guess you would call them. Because they say the way it's done, it's not examined, the individual is not examined face to face. Which is how long it takes to transport. that you can't come and say this because you agree at not having sent in some sort of hybrid document.
There was a litigated trial.
Yeah.
There was a litigated trial.
That's why I guess I didn't quite understand how this document came about. It wasn't a consent decree. It wasn't whatever it is. But are they stopped? Can they now say, look, okay, we keep the 24 hours. We don't have any problem with the 24 hours, but we want some. It's unreasonable for 100% and not counting the transportation and not having a mechanism in place which prevents people from being sent and then sent back. In the meantime, taking up beds that might be better used by others. That's their argument.
So they
can't make that argument today because of this plan.
They absolutely can make that argument. They have that opportunity every single day under Rule 60 and under the PLRA. They have to meet their burden of showing that their plan would be equally effective at remediating the constitutional violation. The district court reviewed all of the evidence and testimony in support of their positions and made specific factual findings that are reviewed for clear error about why it would not only push remediation of the constitutional violations even further down the line, but would actually exacerbate harm to the plaintiff class. And I'm happy to talk to you about exactly why that is, but I also want to clear up a misperception about what the rescissions actually result in. These are not people that are in crisis beds that we are discussing. These are people in alternative housing. They're not holding up beds that are going to be used for other people. This is all before anybody gets to a crisis bed, okay? So we're talking about administrative staff and the workload for them. We're not talking about taking up precious crisis beds. So that was not at issue there. And more importantly, not only did the district court evaluate all of the evidence of why expanding the amount of time in alternative housing was bad, she took new testimony about what it was. And some of the testimony that was before her was a California State Auditor report from 2017, the same year, saying that the defendants had failed to properly implement their suicide prevention policies. Their suicide rate remained sky high, far above the national average. And they also had the suicide prevention expert report literally filed a week before the hearing on this, finding that people were still being housed in, quote, horrendous, outrageous settings while they were awaiting crisis care. They received no treatment in those places. There were people strapped to gurneys for 3 days who were suicidal, who urinated all over themselves because they were waiting for crisis care. There were people that were not observed as they were required to be by defendants' policies who killed themselves. And I'll just note that both of those are remarkably similar to circumstances that the Supreme Court described in 2011 when they described people being held standing room only while suicidal in cages overnight, urinating on themselves, not receiving treatment, and when they also described somebody who committed suicide in the record before the Supreme Court who killed themselves while they were supposed to be observed in alternative housing and were not. So nothing has changed, Your Honor. And moreover, it is...
But what the Supreme Court was describing, was that systematic or is that something that happens because somebody didn't do their job in a particular case?
The Supreme Court noted that as evidence of the ongoing failure to comply with the Eighth Amendment command to provide timely access to adequate care. They found that specific violation inciting that evidence remained ongoing. So it's exactly the same constitutional standard that the district court applied, looked at the evidence before it, and determined nothing had changed. And moreover, defendants like to say that those are outlier examples in 2017. The suicide prevention expert found that 40% of the institutions he reviewed were not compliant with their suicide prevention policies. That's not an outlier. 40% of the institutions were not. So that's the evidence before the district court. And moreover, there is other evidence, and the district court was allowed to look at this. Its earlier findings, both the Supreme Court in the Plata v. Brown case and the Ninth Circuit in the Armstrong 2014 case, said that it is entirely permissible and appropriate for the district court to look at earlier holdings and findings that are in the record when the court is managing a long, complex remedy. There was plenty of evidence in the record that mental health crisis beds, that delays in crisis care make people sicker, it increases the suicide rate, it causes people to be held in settings that cause them to decompensate and sometimes falsely recant real suicidal ideation, which again contributes to the very high suicide rate in this system. And all of that evidence was before the court. They have never been in compliance with the 24-hour transfer timeline, never. And the district court did not abuse its authority in finding not only could it force them to finally come into compliance if they are willing, not only that, but not to expand the harm to the plaintiff class by allowing them to further delay the treatment that people receive. People don't receive any mental health treatment while they're in the alternative housing. There is evidence in the record of that. Dr. Brizendine did testify to that. They don't receive any care while they're sitting on a van, and that is uncontested. So the burden was on the state to establish that something has changed that would make it appropriate for them to expand the amount of time people spend in these settings not receiving any care.
Well, they not possible to receive care on a van as it's traveling. I don't know what the distances and the times that it...
In California, they can be great. I mean, it can. There are only a certain number of crisis bed units at certain prisons in the system, and there are cases where they have traveled 8 hours on a van to a crisis bed. So it can be a long time. And moreover, the state, even if it's a one-hour drive, the state has agreed that it is clinically appropriate for people to receive care in a licensed unit for suicidality within 24 hours. They can make their staff account for that 1 hour in those 24 hours. They just told you up here that 24 hours is the clinically appropriate standard. They have never, again, they've never, there are internal processes in the program guide itself. They can administratively change things in the program guide. They can move before the court, but Rule 60, always available to them. It's an equity court. The court is flexible. They have to meet their burden of showing that their alternative is equally effective at remediating existing constitutional violations, and they just didn't do that. That's reviewed, all of the factual findings are reviewed for clear error, and it's an abuse of discretion standard, and there's just no question the district court had more than enough evidence before it to issue these rulings.
Can I ask you about the rescission thing?
Yes.
I thought the district court made a factual finding that actually there wasn't any evidence that there was a correlation between the not being able to do the face-to-face thing. Can you remind
me? That's correct. So there actually is nothing in the record saying that there is anything showing that it is more effective, that you basically get a better read of the person to get a more accurate sense of whether they're suicidal if you review them in person. There was a fundamental mismatch between the data that was provided to the court in support of that notion and the actual reality on the ground. Defendants provided evidence comparing the rate from 5 p.m. to 5 a.m., and then, you know, the alternative, 5 a.m. to 5 p.m., and said it's much higher at night. The problem with that, however, is that there is not a single prison in the state of California that operates from 5 p.m. to 5 a.m. with no clinical staff, or that opens at 5 a.m. for business and has clinical staff. So there's nothing in the data that actually maps to the allegation, or I should say to the modification and the rationale for it that the state provided. So there's no affirmative evidence that shows that there is anything that is better about an in-person clinical assessment that would actually reduce the rescission rate. And again, that's not people that are in crisis beds. Those are people that are waiting in alternative housing. So we're purely talking about administrative staff functions. So unless you have further questions on the mental crisis bed appeal, I'd like to
One further point. Just am I remembering right that the district court, in response to their arguments about the Eighth Amendment and there needing to be fresh findings and all that, just basically said, no, that has already been settled, and I'm not going to revisit that given what was decided in 2013 and 2014?
I, I don't necessarily think that that's exactly accurate, because the district court did cite its earlier findings. Again, this is a chance for defendants to show that something's changed. So the standards remain themselves. This is essentially an enforcement motion. She wasn't required to make new findings of an ongoing constitutional violation, because I'm speaking as to the 100% compliance portion here, because she was merely enforcing an existing valid order that defendants have never moved to modify or terminate. So, and moreover, the
but it
record
wasn't always 100%.
It was. I'm not aware of most orders that I've received in court.
I thought they quoted from it.
Yes, I'm saying that I'm not aware of most district court orders saying or even implying that you can choose how often that you want to comply. Typically, when you're ordered to do something, in my experience, and you're a district court judge, you know a lot more than I do, but typically you're required to comply, and that's it. And moreover, they've had plenty of time to come into compliance. And at the time of the district court's order, they were 25% of the time they were late. So we're not talking about
25% they were on time. I guess my next question is it your view that they haven't made any improvements from the time that this document was, this program guide was put into place?
In the system overall?
Yeah.
I think that there has been some very good work. I think that to get out of this case, which is what the district court's mission is, she is looking very affirmatively to find ways to encourage defendants to be compliant and remain compliant with the benchmarks that they developed for establishing the constitutional remedy in this case. So she's very focused and has been very dedicated in essentially saying, here are the standards, you've developed them, and I've ordered you to comply with them for decades. You've never done it, so start doing it. And that's the mandate of the court, and I think that's what the Supreme Court requires her to do. She's required to affirmatively remediate the constitutional violations in this case, according to Plata v. Brown, which is this case.
Now,
that's her command.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
What discussions, I think you may allude to them in your brief, were going on when the notice of appeal was filed and the district judge said, stop everything because I can't do anything since my jurisdiction has been ousted?
Right. So prior to the notice of appeal, actually, over the summer, because her initial order in April is the order that required us to meet and confer about these exceptions, and we filed a stipulation in, I believe, July of 2017, so before the notice of appeal, saying that we had generally agreed to three categories. We filed this with the court. The categories were people that are out to court, people that are out for medical conditions that are more sort of significant or more important at the time than the mental health crisis. And a general other category that literally covers any circumstance that's outside the state's control. And it also said that we hadn't refined the exact language in the program guide, but we had stipulated to those categories. We were continuing to discuss other categories as well.
Well, that's
and
that's
that got called off.
But that's one of the things that troubles me, because we don't, had this discussions, these discussions not been stopped. And the last category you mentioned was a general one. It might have been adopted. We might have been reviewing an order that's different from what we're reviewing, because progress was being made, and in fact the last clause was a sort of an open-ended safety valve. I'm just using broad language. You understand what I mean?
Right.
So are we actually reviewing what would likely have been the final outcome if your discussions had not been interrupted by the filing of a notice of appeal?
I think there is some legitimate question as to whether or not the portion of the October 10th order that pertains to 100% compliance is appropriately before this court under pendant jurisdiction principles. I don't think there's any question that the portion that refused to allow defendants to modify the remedial plan with regard to transport time and the in-person versus on-call.
I know, but that's there. But then what you described that you were negotiating, they could conceivably come to you and under this safety valve clause, which I'm using for short, and say, you know, maybe we could do a little something.
Yeah, I mean, we've already, like I said, stipulated to the court that we've agreed to these three exceptions. They are, by the way, the
What you've described seems to me entirely reasonable, but that's not what we're being asked to review, because it was never, you know, the process was interrupted by this filing of a notice of appeal.
The process was interrupted, but I also think that, you know, those are the same.
This I get from your brief, not from them.
Yes.
This is in your brief.
Yes. Those three exceptions that I described that we stipulated to that the court didn't formally order because we were still working on them, those are the same three same three exceptions that we agreed to in the inpatient context, which were court ordered. So I don't think there's any question the court would have approved those three.
No, I agree.
There may have been others, but the point is that there is no perfect compliance standard here. There are a whole host of exceptions that defendants can utilize and that they do utilize to excuse tardiness. The exceptions don't cover circumstances that are wholly in their control when they've had 20 years to figure out how to comply with these standards that are, again, their own standards.
Is this the first time that this case has been to this court since Brown v. Plata?
Yes. Like I said, it was fully briefed in 2013 on the termination motion, and there were actually two other related appeals in 2013, and the state voluntarily dismissed all three after briefing.
What do you want to say about the other appeal?
So I think the point with respect to the inpatient appeal, one of the critical points is that I think Judge Corman was asking about basically sort of the magnitude of the problem. And I think what the district court was seeing in the fall of 2015 and 2016 was that the gains that the court had praised in 2013 were evaporating.
Yeah, and but I thought my impression was, and you could correct me, that it was because there was a sudden increase in the numbers of people who needed it.
So the bed planning projections that defendants receive showed that they, and the district court found in the after significant evidence and testimony in the March 24th order, which preceded and was integrated into the April 19th order, found that defendants had many, many options and that it was feasible for them to comply. And defendants don't contest that. They agree that it is feasible for them to comply with the inpatient transfer timelines. So they don't challenge that factual finding, nor could they, because that was their testimony. So they have plenty of options available to them to timely transfer people to inpatient care. And I've lost the thread on your question. Did you?
Well, you started it.
I did.
You
okay.
said to get back to what Judge Corman said.
Oh, right. Excuse me, Your Honor. Thank you. Yes. So the point I was planning to make is that the history of this case, and this is another great reason to defer to the district court, the history of this case is that the inpatient transfer timelines sometimes get better, sometimes get worse, but it's a persistent chronic cycle. And so when the district court found that they were again creeping up into the dozens and then into the 60s, and I believe it got around 100 of people waiting past transfer timelines, the district court put a stop to it and said, look, we need to finally fix this problem. You can do it. It's feasible. You don't challenge that finding, so just do it. And I defer to you 100% about all the mechanisms you want to do that. Just do it and get it done, and then we can put this portion of the case behind us. So the court is really trying to drive toward resolution of this case, and the contempt findings, you know, the preliminary contempt findings, obviously, there was never a hearing where they were actually found in contempt or sanctioned, another reason this is not an appealable order. But her methods are working. They've been in compliance with the transfer timelines for a year at this point, and that is unprecedented in this case. So the district court knows what she is doing, and there's plenty of case law in Armstrong in this court that says the district court managing complex litigation should be given even more deference than normal when you're reviewing an abuse of discretion standard, which is what is governing these appeals.
Could I ask one more question?
Yes.
It doesn't deal specifically with this, but who's the policymaker here? I know New York is just terrible in dividing responsibility, so everybody is responsible and no one's responsible. Who is deciding this? How does this work? Is it the Attorney General deciding whether to take this position? Is the governor deciding whether to take this position? Is somebody else? I'm just trying to understand.
I think that's an excellent question for opposing counsel.
Okay.
I'm not really in a position to know that. But okay. I do want to point out just one more bit of essentially harm with respect to the inpatient transfer timelines. And that is, as the district court very extensively laid out, not only is it a perpetual cycle in this case, but that perpetual cycle trickles down to every level of care. So when there are delays at the top, there are delays in MHCBs, there are delays in every other level of care down the stream. And all of that exacerbates and makes people actually sicker. And it also causes clinicians to stop referring people because they know it's going to be a long time. I may as well just keep them here and try and treat them as best I can locally. So all of those are evidence of harm. And I think there's no question that the district court found that the policies and procedures that the state is putting into place were not sufficient to obviate that substantial risk of serious harm under the Eighth Amendment. So to the extent that the subjective intent analysis is before this court, there's more than enough of a record to show that, you know, in taking the long way to build new new crisis beds when they could have taken the short way, when they had plenty of bed plans that were telling them for years in advance that they were going to be short on crisis beds, for failing to transfer people to inpatient care on time when it was feasible, all of that is more than sufficient to establish deliberate indifference and the Eighth Amendment violation here.
Thank you, counsel.
Thank you.
Let's put 3 minutes on the clock for counsel for the state. And given the lateness of the hour, I'm going to hold you to the 3 minutes, so please try to be succinct in your
rebuttal. Could I ask you what your adversary says was a great question to ask you? Who decides this? I mean, who is the policymaker here? Is it the Attorney General? Is it the governor? Who is instructing you to take the positions that you're taking? I'm just trying to understand. I mean, California, after all, is not Alabama.
You mean the legal positions?
Yes, the positions that you're taking now. Who is the policymaker?
Well, I believe that it would be from the defendants in this case, the governor, the secretary of the department,
You believe or you know?
yes. Those are the officials that are being sued in their official capacity, and the policies that are made, those are things that are the mental health policies. But if you're asking about the legal positions, the specific legal positions, then this is a collaboration with the executive staff. This is executive branch decision making,
including the governor,
the governor and the secretary of the department. And
I'm sorry. I hope Judge Watford gives you.
He has a minute and a half left.
Not at all.
Be quick,
Your Honor. I would address the exceptions very quickly. And Judge Corman, your concern about the interruption regarding with the exceptions and how it interrupted. And I would just say that the exceptions and the fact that the last category is somewhat still a little bit amorphous is not enough to make the order at issue non-final. What the district court did is it announced its constitutional ruling, and in the post-judgment context, this court gives a practical construction of finality to orders, because it's not clear whether there will be some further order down the road that will be appealable.
Well, an order could be to hold you in contempt, and you could appeal from the contempt order. That's one argument that's not frivolous. It may not apply here, but it seemed to me that things were going along, and you suddenly file a notice of appeal. Was your time running out?
Because the order constitutes injunctive relief, we would not have the ability under Ninth Circuit case law to challenge the terms of that relief following a contempt order. Because the order that's being disobeyed, we would be barred from challenging that.
You were talking about exceptions, one of which was a fairly, and at least in its language, was fairly broad. I've called it safety valve. And why did you cut it short by filing a notice of appeal?
I believe because the order was still granting injunctive relief, and it's unclear as to whether there would be some subsequent appealable order afterwards that we would be able to appeal. So we wouldn't have the ability to effectively appeal.
Thank you, counsel. The case just argued will be submitted. And to be clear, we're submitting both 17-17328 and 17-16080. Court is in recess until tomorrow.